Let us pray the prayer for peace. Eternal God, creator of the universe, there is no God but you. Great and wonderful are your works. Wondrous are your ways. Thank you for the many splendored variety of your creation. Thank you for the many ways we affirm your presence and purpose, and the freedom to do so. Forgive our violation of your creation. Forgive our violence towards each other. We stand in awe and gratitude for your persistent love, as well as those with other faiths. Grant to all and our leaders attributes of the strong mutual respect in words and deed, restrain in the exercise of power and the will for peace with justice for all. Eternal God, creator of the universe, there is no God but you. Amen.
Good day to each and everyone. My name is Regiboy Ayueska, reporting about the ethical teachings on Hinduism, Buddhism, and Confucianism.
Now, my first topic is about the ethical teachings on Hinduism. Introduction on Hinduism. Hinduism is an Indian religion and dharma, or way of life. It is the world's third largest religion, with over 1.2 billion followers, or 15 to 16% of the global population known as Hindus. Hinduism has been called the oldest and the first religion in the world. The main symbol of Hinduism is called Om, or Om. It represents the spirit of all things in the world. The name Om represents the sound that was made when the universe was created. Hinduism is a collection of religious beliefs that developed slowly over a long period of time. Hindus believe that their religion helps you free your soul from the sadness, disappointments, and mistakes of everyday life. Unlike other major religions like Buddhism of Siddhartha Gautama, Islam of Prophet Muhammad, Christianity of Jesus Christ, and Judaism, it cannot be tracked back to a single founder. Now let's move on about Hindu gods. There are hundreds of different Hindu gods, and not all Hindus worship all gods. Sometimes families have a certain favorite god they worship, or regions in India have favorite gods. Let's proceed about the three supreme gods of Hindus, or the big three. Hindus believes the spirit of the universe takes the form of three main gods. Hindus can choose to pray to all of these forms. Some praise only two, or even only one, or nothing. One of the Hindu gods, or the supreme gods of Hindus, is Brahma, or the creator. In Hinduism, Brahma connotes the highest universal principle, the ultimate reality in the universe. In major schools of Hindu philosophy, it is the material, efficient, formal, and the final cause of all that exists. The second supreme god of Hindus is Vishnu, or the protector, also known as the perseverer. Vishnu is one of three supreme Hindu deities, along with Brahma and Shiva. Vishnu's role is to protect humans and to restore order to the world. His presence is found in every object and force in creation, and some Hindus recognize him as the divine being from which all things come. The third supreme god of Hindus is Shiva, or the destroyer. Shiva is often referred to as the destroyer, but in reality, it is he who destroys the impurities taking refuge in the human mind. He rids a body of its shortcomings and makes it worthy of attaining moksha. Now let's proceed to the holy texts of Hindus, Vedas and Upanishads. The Vedas, from 1700 to 500 BC, and the Upanishads, from 750 to 550 BC are the collection of writings that describe all the fundamental teachings that are central to Hinduism, including the concepts of karma, samsara, and moksha. Vedas of 1700 to 500 BC. The Vedas are a large body of religious texts originating in ancient India, composed in Vedic Sanskrit. The texts constitute the oldest layer of Sanskrit literature and the oldest scriptures of Hinduism. Upanishads of 750 to 500 BC. The Upanishads are the philosophical religious texts of Hinduism, also known as Sanatan Dharma, meaning eternal order or eternal path, which develop and explain the fundamental tenets of the religion. Upanishad has also been interpreted to mean secret teaching or revealing underlying truth. Now let's proceed about the Hindus' beliefs. Samsara or reincarnation, karma or actions, and moksha or nirvana. Samsara or reincarnation. This process of reincarnation is called samsara, a continuous cycle in which the soul is reborn over and over again, according to the law of action and reaction. At death, many Hindus believe that soul is carried by a subtle body into a new physical body, which can be a human or non-human form, an animal or divine being. Karma or actions. Karma is a concept of Hinduism which explains through a system where beneficial effects are derived from past beneficial actions and harmful effects from past harmful actions, creating a system of actions and reactions throughout a soul's reincarnated lives, forming a circle of birth. As the Golden Rule said, do not do unto others what you don't want do unto you, and do unto others what you want to do unto you. Moksha or Nirvana. Moksha is the end of the death and rebirth cycle, and is classed as the fourth and ultimate artha or goal. It is the transcendence of all arthas. It is achieved by overcoming ignorance and desires. It is a paradox in the sense that overcoming desires also includes overcoming the desires for moksha itself. Now let's proceed about the four goals of life in Hinduism. First is Dharma. It's an important term in Indian religions. In Hinduism, it means duty, virtue, morality, even religion, and it refers to the power which upholds the universe and society. In short, be a good, virtuous, and moral person. Second is artha, wealth or property. In Hinduism, the pursuit of wealth or material advantage, furthermore, artha as the pursuit of material advantage is closely tied to the activities of statecraft, which maintains the general social order. And the third one is kama. This Sanskrit word means love, desire, and pleasure. It is a very practical part of Hindus' aim in life. Hindus aim to achieve pleasure in many ways, including sporting activities and cultural interest. But it is important to note that kama is also derived from sexual pleasure. Seek happiness, pleasure, emotional fulfillment like love, friendship, and community. And the last one is moksha. Seek freedom from ignorance, spirituality, and self-knowledge. Now, let's proceed about the ethical teachings on Buddhism. Introduction on Buddhism. The founder of Buddhism is Siddhartha Gautama. He was born into a wealthy family, and prophecies stated that if he stayed home, he would become a king. And if he left home, he would become a spiritual leader. His family chose to keep him sheltered at home, not allowing him to leave the palace. Gautama lived in luxury and safety in the walls of the palace. Now let's talk about Siddhartha Gautama. Gautama felt that the world had so much more to offer than this home. So at age of 29, he snapped out. In his time outside, he realized that the world outside was the opposite from what he was used to at home. First, he sees an old man. Second, he sees a sick man. And the third, he sees a corpse, followed by a holy man who seemed to be at peace with himself. He decided then that his mission in life would be to find inner peace and freedom from the suffering in the world. The three suffering in the world that he sees: old man or aging, sick man or disease, and the third is corpse or death. To reach religious enlightenment, he first tried fasting, debating others, and wandering through forest. It was only after meditation for 49 days under a tree where Gautama was able to reach enlightenment, perfect understanding of the world, and earn the title the Enlightened One, otherwise known as the Buddha. Now, let's talk about the Four Noble Truths of Buddhism. After his meditation, the Buddha discovered the Four Noble Truths, which became the core beliefs of Buddhism. And the Four Noble Truths are: number one, to live is to suffer. Number two, suffering is caused by desire. Number three, to eliminate suffering, you must eliminate desire. Number four, you can eliminate desire by following the Eightfold Path. Now, let's talk about the Eightfold Path. Buddhists must follow the Eightfold Path in order to reach Nirvana. Nirvana is the state to which all Buddhists aspire. It's the cessation of desire and hence the end of suffering. The Noble Eightfold Path. The Path of Wisdom. First, right understanding. Understanding that the Four Noble Truths are noble and true. Second, right aspiration. Determining and resolving to practice Buddhist faith. The Path of Morality. Right speech. Avoiding slander, gossip, lying, and all forms of untrue and abusive speech. Right conduct. Adhering to the idea of nonviolence, as well as refraining from any form of stealing or sexual impropriety. Right livelihood, not slaughtering animals or working at jobs that force you to violate others. And the path of concentration. First is the right effort, avoiding negative thoughts and emotion such as anger and jealousy. Right mindfulness, having a clear sense of one's mental state and bodily health and feelings. Third, and the last one, right concentration, using meditation to reach the highest level of enlightenment. Now, let's proceed about the ethical teachings of Confucianism. Introduction of Confucianism. A philosophical comprise of teachings of Confucius who live around 551 to 479 BCE. The philosophy of Confucius, the founder, emphasized personal and governmental morality, correctness of social relationship, justice and sincerity. These values gained prominence in China over other doctrines, such as legalism or Taoism, during Han Dynasty of 206 BC and 220 AD. Let's talk about the founder of Confucianism, and it is Confucius. He is Chinese philosopher, government official, wandering from region to region within China, a wandering teacher. The virtue he is most often remembered for is that is filial piety, the belief that son should respect and be faithful to their fathers. Confucius thoughts have been developed into a system of philosophy known as Confucianism. The Analects, also known as the Analects of Confucius, is an ancient Chinese book composed of a large collection of sayings and ideas attributed to the Chinese philosopher Confucius and his contemporaries. Now let's proceed about the Confucian beliefs. First is the five important beliefs of Confucianism. Yi, or righteousness. Xin, honesty and trustworthiness. Cheng, loyalty to the state and etc. Li, includes ritual, propriety, etiquette and etc. And Xiao, love within the family, love of the parents for their children, and love of children for their parents. Four main principles of Confucianism. The four cardinal principles are a set of Confucian foundational principles of morality. The first four cardinal principles are propriety, accepted standards of behavior or morals. Righteousness, the quality of being morally right or justifiable. Integrity, being honest and having a strong moral principles and moral uprightness. And shame, a feeling of embarrassment or humiliation. The main idea of Confucianism is the more importance of having a good moral character, which can then affect the world around that person taught the idea of cosmic harmony. If the emperor has moral perfection, his rule will be peaceful and benevolent. Confucius taught to cultivate compassion and practice concern for others. He insisted on emphasizing and extending virtues to others as the way to cultivate humanity. The basic idea of Zen illustrates how human beings should relate to one another in society. The concepts of respect for autonomy, beneficence, non-maleficence, and justice, and the moral values of these four prima facie principles have been expressly identified in Confucius ethics. There are a few core values of Confucianism. One is called Zen. It prioritizes human-heartedness, goodness, benevolence, dignity for the human life, and last but not the least, characteristics that make humans humans. Confucius believed that all people and the society they lived in benefit from a lifetime of learning and a moral outlook. Confucius was a Chinese philosopher, politician, and a teacher whose message of knowledge, benevolence, loyalty, and virtue were the main guiding philosophy of China for the thousands of years. Confucianism is a philosophy based on mutual respect and kindness toward others. It was developed to bring peace and stability in the society. Now, let's talk about some of the famous quotes of Confucius. First, the man who asks a question is a fool for a minute, and the man who does not ask is fool for life. Second, the man who says he can and the man who says he cannot are both correct. Third, life is very simple, but we insist making it complicated. And the famous one, the golden rule. Do not do to others what you do not want done to yourself.
And that's the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening.